should have a good idea of the location of the observatory or satellite that is doing that imaging because of the opacity of the atmosphere. So X-rays and gamma rays and almost all ultraviolet, you have to be above the atmosphere. A little bit of that ultraviolet comes in. That's what gives you your beautiful sunburn in the summer. Then, of course, visible, we can see mostly from the Earth, but there is distortion from the atmosphere that has to be taken into account. Most of the infrared has to be done from space. A lot of the radio waves observable from ground-based telescopes, but the very long wavelength radio waves, you have to be, again, above the atmosphere. And understanding the relationship between stellar temperatures, radii, and luminosities. If we look at, for instance, there's Alpha Orionis, Betelgeuse to you. Here are two white dwarf images. And then down here we have Proxima Centauri. Now, Alpha Orionis and Proxima Centauri have the same stellar classification. But they're obviously very different from each other. This is a red supergiant on its way to collapse into probably a neutron star. This is Proxima Centauri, which is going to just burble along for another trillion years and just slowly turn into a white dwarf when the fusion process is stopped. This one is very smaller than the Sun. The radius is much smaller than the Sun. This one, the diameter, it would fit inside about out to the orbit of Jupiter. That's how large that is. So this, the HR diagram where they're located, tells you a lot about the radius of these objects also. Even if they have the same, quote, temperature or classification, they can be very, very different in size. And that size depends upon the processes ongoing within the star. Down here, here's another example of different wavelengths for the same object. This is right here. This is an optical image taken by the McDonnell Observatory of Sirius, a white dwarf. However, white dwarfs radiate strongly in X-ray and very little in optical. This arrow is pointing to the white dwarf, and this is its, so that's Sirius B, white dwarf. This is the primary star, Sirius A. This is a binary system, and this is the exact same image in X-ray. So now, what you're looking at, this bright primary one in the front, that's not the primary star. That is the white dwarf, because the white dwarf radiates much more in X-ray than it does in optical. So for this one, the bright primary star right here, Sirius A, that is Sirius A, it's that little one in the background, and the one in front is actually the white dwarf. So you see, you really need to pay attention to the wavelength. Here are a couple of examples of HR diagrams that you can find. For instance, here's Procyon, Alpha Centauri, Proxima Centauri down here. Here we have Aldebaran, Antares, Betelgeuse. And you can see where they are. There's the Nav Rigel just starting their transition over to this super red giant stage. Here's another one. So you can find HR diagrams out there that will show you where these deep sky objects are located. Blackbody radiation, about all that I think that you would need to know about this are the first two laws. Basically that a black body is something that absorbs all radiation that it receives and then emits it all away. So everything that comes in goes out. And stellar surfaces or atmospheres, stellar atmospheres are very good black body radiators because they absorb all the emission coming from the core, being produced by the core, and then it emits it all out into the interstellar medium. So basically the only thing that you need to really understand here is that the hotter the star, the more energy it emits at every single wavelength than a cooler star. So here is a 12,000 K star, and we have a 6,000 K star, and a 3,000 K star. And nowhere does this 3,000 K star emit more radiation at any wavelength than a hotter star. So that is basically Planck's law. Wayne's law tells you that the maximum peak radiation that comes from any star or black body, that peak has a specific temperature that is related to the actual wavelength measurement. So the maximum peak radiation from any star is equal to this divided by T. So you can determine the wave. If you, from your spectra, your absorption line, you go down, it tells you what the wavelength is, and then you can plug it into this equation, and that tells you the temperature of the star. For resources, the astronomy coaches manual that is located in the National Science Olympiad store online. Even though it was written for astronomy, it has the same content that's covered in the Reach for the Stars also, so that's and it has a lot of investigations and activities, a lot of information on how to study and prepare. So that is actually a good guide even for the Reach for the Stars event. APOD, Astronomy Picture of the Day, is a good place to go to. If you do a search for a deep sky object, usually that first page of images that comes up, you will have images of several different wavelengths. That's a good place to collect images from. The Chandra, of course, website has a lot of materials. It has a lot of images in the photo album. And the webinar will be posted there. And the AABSO website also will have a link to the webinar. The 2002 event is already posted there for you to download and use as a practice. And this PowerPoint will also be located here too, be posted here also. The PowerPoint is, I believe, has already been posted. And of course, the Chandra website has a lot of stellar evolution materials and resources to help you learn about stellar evolution. Excellent materials from pencil and paper to online web quests to flash versions, and a lot of materials that you might want to request for your team. So, the National Event Supervisor, Dusty Schroeder, that is his email. If you have any questions about the event, then you can contact Dusty. If you have any kind of a question about the resources or the location or the setup, if you're confused about something, don't email Dusty, because other people might have the same confusion or misunderstanding. So if you go to the national website and go to event information, that's a place where people who have questions about clarification issues about the event description or resources, they go there and they ask their question. So if you have a question, go there, look, and see if someone has asked that exact same question and if it's been answered. And if no one has posted that question yet, then you can post it and they will send you an answer. And if they don't know the answer, then they will email Dusty and then he will get back to them. So it just makes it a little easier if it's all done in the same place. So to prepare for the event, read the event description very carefully. Know exactly what your allowable resources are. You do not want to be DQ'd or have to leave your resources outside the room because they're not appropriate. Use the webinar and the PowerPoint for an overview of the deep sky objects and the content. Use the coach's manual, astronomy coach's manual, as a guide for how to collect the images and information for next year's competition, 2013. Use the websites. Now, Dusty has listed several websites in the event at the bottom of the event description, which is in your student manual. He has listed the URLs for the websites that he has determined will be the most useful for you. So stick to those websites. Don't go wandering out into the big wide internet. Stick with those in particular. You don't need anything. Everything you need for the event will be in those those very places. Download the 2002 Reach for the Stars event from AAVSO to practice with and use as a guide. If you did not participate in the 2012 national competition, you would not believe the star charts that were involved with that competition. There were eight. Five of them were, I had never seen star charts exactly like that before. So just downloading and practicing, because the answer key is there also. Practicing and doing that event is the best thing you can do to prepare for competition. And if you have any questions about that, if you cannot determine, if you cannot get the answer that's listed in the answer key, then you should email Dustin and he will help you out with any difficulties. So thank you very much and good luck. And may the stars be with you for the 2013 Reach for the